Pastor Carlson would just like me to remind you that with the change in speakers today, the order of the sermon and the title is different than that which is published in the brochure there. And he will preach some other time. I didn't expect his kindness to do that, but when he called me and I realized that he changed his plans to allow this. And so I thank Pastor Carlson very much for his kindness and allowing me to be here and to present today. Thank you for that beautiful music, for the prayers, the testimonies. It is such a special Thanksgiving. It has been. We had one last week with my parents and brothers and families, and then another one here with the in-laws. And so we got a double Thanksgiving, doubly thankful. And I wish I had prepared a sermon just for Thanksgiving, but I wasn't expecting to preach today. Last week I was hoping to find an English church, but it was a Spanish church that invited me, so I did a different sermon. But this sermon that I'm going to preach today, that present to you, was prepared some months ago in Spanish, and I translated it into English. Hopefully I got all the words. My wife pointed out to me that I missed a few, so I had to retranslate. So if there's some Spanish words here, you know I did it this morning. But the subject is a subject that is to awaken us to the reality of, first of all, our mission that we have. We have a sacred mission. The Seventh-day Adventist Church has been blessed with a sacred mission to prepare the world for Jesus' second coming. Amen. Satan's special hatred and attack is against that message, against the mission of the church, and against the church itself. And so therefore, as we look at some of the things, let us realize that in order to carry forward the truth, truth has always had to go forward against great obstacles, correct? Millions have given their lives in order to advance the truth and to stand for the truth. And therefore, as we go forward into the final battle, we can expect that and not be surprised when there are difficulties in our path. It's a war. Now, as a soldier comes back from the war, he talks about the war. I spend my life on the front lines. So naturally, I come back with fresh stories of the battle on the front lines. God is winning as the winds are being held a little longer. So God's people, God's chosen remnant people, will have time to prepare. But the winds will not hold forever. And so I hope today will help you to awake to the reality of a great work that has to be done in a short time. And that you yourself will make a commitment. Renew your commitment if you've already made it, or if you haven't, to make the commitment to dedicate all you have and all you are to carry forward this precious truth in these last days. It's a great privilege to be an ambassador. But as an ambassador friend of mine from the Philippines told me, an ambassador may never say what they want to say. They must only say the words they are told to say. An ambassador never says, "In my opinion." An ambassador only says the words that their chief of state has told them to say. And as ambassadors, we are to reflect Christ and His mission on earth in everything we do and say, the way we dress, the way we eat, what we look at, what we read, and what we hear. Would you bow your heads with me as we ask God's special presence to speak to each heart, please? Heavenly Father, thank you for the beautiful music, for the testimonies, the beautiful time together in this your house. In your day that you separated from the very beginning of creation, you set aside the seventh day to spend special time with your children. Today, now, as we present this subject, Lord, we recognize we are involved in a great war. It's a war that began in heaven, but it's a war that will also end with great joy in heaven. So we pray that you will speak to our hearts. Prepare us. May we hear the words that you say, and may you take out of our hearts and minds anything that might interrupt. Encircle this, your house, with your holy angels, eliminating all other influences except your Holy Spirit. And we pray and we thank you. In the all-powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Satan has discovered that the best way to attack God's people is secretly. not overtly. He tried doing it for 1260 years, an overt attack against truth. More than 30 million people gave their lives during the Middle Ages, standing for truth. But as someday we will understand, there will be more people in heaven. As fast as Satan kills them, that's how fast their lives are sealed for eternity. So he thought to himself, I will do it covertly, so that they will be lost without ever getting prepared. And Christian service tells us that the greatest strategy is to keep God's people asleep. We will look at some things. I was recently in Europe. I went to Romania. I saw some interesting things. I saw some interesting houses. And I don't see houses like that too often around the United States. I saw some interesting airplanes. You don't see some of those airplanes around Collegedale Airport. Different manufacturers, different shapes. As a pilot, I'm interested. I found something other things that are interesting. I bought a hat made out of a mushroom. It looks like leather, but that hat, I bought it for me to wear, but it looks prettier on my wife. So I gave it to her. But it's made out of one piece of mushroom. And during one of our trips in Romania, we went to the top of a mountain to visit a shepherd family. A family that spent their time there, and they were so kind to us. They said, if you will come live in Romania, we'll give you a house and build you a little house to live in on this mountaintop. How sweet! What a beautiful place to live, surrounded by sheep and the winds and in nature. But of course, that's not the task. That we couldn't accept that, but that was very nice. The shepherd had his dog there, and when he sent the dog out to bring the sheep in, all of them lined up, and they all came following by themselves, and the dog was in the back bringing in all the sheep. The shepherd just waited until the dog brought in all the sheep. And when the job was done, it's like he posed in front of his sheep. I couldn't believe the picture I got, saying, my job is done, here they are. Everybody smile. They all lined up right behind the dog in a line, and they all stood there for the picture. The shepherd started milking the sheep. And then I said, I grew up milking cows. Can I also try? So he gave me a chance. And I milked as well. After we were done, he took me outside and he put me on his horse. And then he gave me his jacket to wear. And so I was dressed as a shepherd during those cold days with a sheepskin. And then while I was sitting there, somebody mentioned to me, Uncle David, did you know that only shepherds wear sheepskins? And later I understood what he meant. Because we are told by the Apostle Paul, for this I know that after my departing, grievous wolves shall come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples. And who are wolves in the Bible? According to Ezekiel 22:27, her princes, it says, talking about Israel, are like wolves, do shed blood to destroy souls and to get dishonest gain. And Zephaniah 3:3, another reference to wolves, it says, her judges are evening wolves. They gnaw not the bones till tomorrow. In Spanish, it says, they gnaw the bones until they gnaw all night until there's no bones left in the morning. Matthew 7:15, beware of false prophets, which come among you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Uncle David said to the young man, remember that it is only shepherds that dress up like sheep. Then I understood better what he was talking about. The sheep don't have to dress like sheep, do they? They're already sheep. It's the shepherds that dress up. So when Paul refers to coming in like wolves dressed in sheep's clothing, who are we talking about? Her princes and her judges. The leaders are the ones who guide sometimes. Because it's not the sheep that dress like sheep, they already are sheep. And so I began to understand and examine my life a little closer, lest I, as a leader, dress like sheep, lead the sheep astray. There is a phrase, a little poem that I ran across that describes very well what shepherds and sheep, the relationship they have. And it's very touching that the family, the leaders and parents are the ones that have to be very careful how they deal with the sheep. So, just a minute. My device decided, there it is, to upgrade. Okay. 'Twas a sheep and not a lamb that strayed away in the parable that Jesus told. A grown-up sheep that had gone astray from the 99 in the fold. Out on the hillside, out in the cold, 'twas a sheep the good shepherd sought. And back to the flock, safe to the fold, was a sheep that the good shepherd brought. And why should for the sheep earnestly long and earnestly hope and pray? Because there is danger that if they go wrong, they will lead the lambs astray. For the lambs will follow the sheep, you know, wherever the sheep may stray. When the sheep go wrong, it will not be long till the lambs are as wrong as they. And so for the sheep we earnestly plead, and for the sake of the lambs today, if the sheep are lost, what a terrible cost some of the lambs will have to pay. All of us are leaders. All of us have an influence. It is our responsibility to lead the lambs. And if we have a shepherd's job, it is our responsibility to feed the sheep. Feed means solid spiritual food. It means things that build the character and build the body. So what is the greatest danger today among God's people? Jesus himself in Matthew 24:24, there says there should arise false Christs and false prophets and show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they would deceive the very elect. The very elect, if it were possible. We could consider the very elect as being the 144,000. There isn't anybody more very elect than they. If it were possible, it would be that hard to detect. Because it comes from the inside. And it is mixed, the mixture of truth and error. Where will these false Christs come from? For this I know, said Paul, that after my departing shall grievous wolves come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Acts 20:29-30. So where do they come from? What is the biggest danger? From the inside. You don't expect it. You expect it from the outside. But when it comes from your own home, it comes from your own self, it comes from your own church body, you don't expect it. That's why it is so difficult to determine. That's why in the last days, we will learn that the only way is to use biblical standards to filter everything. These false leaders will come from within different churches. By the way, it's not just a Seventh-day Adventist church. It's all of Christian churches. All of Christian churches, those that claim to love Christ, are under attack today. But especially the remnant church. But all of them are under attack. To try to change history, to try to change their Protestant roots, to try to get them to forget where they came from. If you don't know where you came from, you don't know where you're going. We in North America are forgetting where we came from. Even President-elect Trump just mentioned recently that we owe a great part of our history and Christianity to Catholic missionaries. He's not a historian. He has no idea. If we would have been a Catholic nation, the history of the United States would have been quite different. We would have had no constitution like the way we do. There are no Catholic countries with constitutions like North America. It is a Protestant constitution. And Protestants are forgetting where they came from. And because of that, we are losing our constitution. So, all churches are under attack today. And if they come from the inside, it's much more hard to identify the wolves from the sheep. How can we tell the difference between the true and the false? Matthew 7, 13 to 18 says very carefully, "Ye shall know them by their fruits. Even so, every good tree that bringeth forth good fruits, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruits." A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Now, this is a little more clear than one would take it to read. If there are good fruits, it is not a corrupt tree. Is that what it says? Is that what it says? If there are good fruits, is it a good tree? Can it be a bad tree? No. If there are evil fruits, can it be a good tree? No. Jesus is very clear here. So what if you have somebody that believes differently than you do with good fruits? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. What if you have somebody, a neighbor, that doesn't believe like you? Are those good fruits? Is it a good tree? So how do you recognize the Holy Spirit in people's lives except by their fruits? Whether they believe like you or do not believe like you, you can recognize the tree by its fruits. If you have somebody that has good fruits, it is a good tree. Treat them with tenderness and care. Good trees have to be nurtured. What if you have bad fruit? Is it a good tree? No. But what if it comes from within your family? What if you have bad fruit? You need to be careful. Don't just say, "Well, I'm okay. I'm better than everybody else." Excuse me. "I'm better than most of the other church members." That's not how you judge people. Comparison. It's not a sliding scale, a relative scale. If you have the fruits of the Spirit, it's of God. And if you don't, it is not of God. Now, of course, we all know, like Paul said, there's two natures wrestling with us, right? Inside of us. But if we're converted and we've given our heart to Christ, we must die daily and let the new Spirit control person rule in our lives. We must clearly understand then, it doesn't matter how religious you are, how well-known or important you are. It doesn't matter how beautiful the words or how pretty the cover of the book. It doesn't matter what church or religion you belong to. If your fruits are disobedience to God and disloyalty to His divine principles, the tree is evil. That's what Jesus taught. Doesn't matter how important you are, how well-known you are, if you teach disloyalty to God and disobedience, the foundation is rotten, built on sand. In the same way, we can tell if, doesn't matter how humble you are, this is maybe the harder one to accept. Sometimes God sends humble messengers, believe it or not. People who are not qualified, sometimes God uses as messengers. How about shepherds out in the field? How about three wise men that aren't even Jewish? Huh? Are you understanding? Sometimes God brings messages through the unexpected sources. You don't look at the messenger and go, "Doesn't look to me like you're qualified," and throw out the message. Look at the message and evaluate it on its own self. Is it a message that God would bring? Yes. Is it truth? Does it fit with Scripture? Yes. Then it's of God. There's a book at the ABC called "A Thousand Shall Fall at Thy Side." No, I'm sorry, not that book. It was another one called "The Man That Could Not Be Killed." You remember that, some of you. Before he was placed in a prison camp, his wife, who was not a Christian, sat up in bed and gave him a prophecy from the Lord. Does God speak through even non-Christians sometimes? Does God speak through donkeys sometimes? So do not judge the message from the messenger. Doesn't matter how humble, how great, or how low their academic achievements. It doesn't matter from what church or denomination he or she comes from. If the fruits teach obedience and loyalty to God, then the tree is good. Judge the message by God's word, not by the looks of the messenger. Everything is to be measured by God's word. It is the only way to know if something is true. To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. Isaiah 8:20. If they do not agree with the law and the testimony, no light, no truth. It is to be rejected. It doesn't matter where it comes from. It doesn't matter how important, how high, what authority the person has. It has to be compared with God's word. And this is where our only hope today inside the church. Every type of message is coming from every direction. The tendency is to say, well, it comes from up there, therefore it must be true. And excuse me, even Paul himself was willing to be judged by God's word. Well, Apostle Paul said it. It must be true. No. Even if Apostle Paul were here, we must still filter his words by God's word. Doesn't matter who it comes from. Now, if you teach a message, can you imagine Noah, how he must have felt after 120 years? He didn't get a lot of results, did he? It must have been a hard thing to teach Noah. Did Noah have any nieces or nephews? He must have, surely. The Bible doesn't say. But he must have aunts or uncles. I mean, people lived a long time in those days. So he must have had family. Did any of his family, other than his wife and children and wives, did they listen to him? None. Zero success. You could ask yourself, well, will people believe me if I say it? That is not the question. The question is it in harmony with God's word? Doesn't matter where it comes from. People can say, that man is crazy. There's no, it's never rained before. It cannot rain. You look at Noah's life and you say, is his life reflect obedience to God? Yes, then the tree is good. The message may seem strange to you. The message may seem impossible to you. But if it is in harmony with God's teaching, the spirit of prophecy and God's word, it is truth. There was a young Jewish man, the name of Martin Gray, who in Poland was arrested and taken to the concentration camp Treblinka, along with millions of other Jewish Poles. He was a personal witness to the unloading of trainfuls of Jewish prisoners, the execution, the burning, the bones, the ashes. One day while he was loading a train, he was able to hide underneath the load, and the train left with him on board, and he escaped. He jumped off the train without too much injury. He went to a Jewish community that was still untouched, and he shared his story with them. It was too hard to believe. You mean they're arresting all our Jewish people and they're taking them into a camp? And you mean they're just slaughtering all of them and they're burning them? Yes. You must be crazy. He said, you have to leave immediately. You must be crazy. In fact, they ridiculed him to the point that he couldn't even open his mouth anymore. So he left by himself. Nobody left with him. It wasn't long before the Germans came, and all those people that ridiculed him all went to their death. Truth is not based on how many people believe. Truth is based on what truth is. Many may not believe it, but it's still the truth. Which is why I like preaching with Christopher Hudson. I was preaching with him last year at this time, out in the South Pacific. You've probably seen him, the Forerunner. And he preaches very straight, And I love the way he finishes when he says, whether you like it or not, the truth is the truth. And that is the truth. The truth doesn't always get accepted, as this young man found. What was left of all those Jews was a pile of ashes. Men and women, children, reduced to ashes, to fertilizer. The secret strategies of the enemy today are to use spiritualism. Satan appears as a benefactor of the race, healing the diseases of the people, professing to present new and a more exalted system of religious faith. But at the same time, he works as a destroyer. His temptations are leading multitudes to their ruin. While Satan says he's healing, in reality, he's destroying. It appears exactly the opposite of what it is. Virtual reality, isn't it? New ways of worship. There are something called Alpha courses that have been taught for quite a few years now, nearly 20 years. It's an interdenominational course designed by a series of interactive sessions. People are invited freely to discuss and to participate in order to present the basics of Christianity. All major Christian denominations have been involved teaching in their churches, homes, work centers, prisons, universities, and other places. In 2008, there was more than 33,000 courses taught in 163 countries. The Catholic Church is a primary force behind this, according to Wikipedia. Although the course is accepted worldwide, we must recognize that it's a strategy of Satan to mix the good and the bad. In fact, mostly good. In fact, food is poisonous by just adding one drop of strychnine. It can be mainly good. It just takes a little bit of poison. We are told we must prove all things and hold fast that which is good. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. That the majority accepts something does not make it or guarantee that it's the truth. Paul lauded the brethren in Berea, where he said they were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and they searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. No matter what you hear from the pulpit, whatever I say or anybody says, you must search it out for yourself. You are responsible for your own salvation, not somebody else. You're responsible for your own salvation. It's interesting that when a deceived person is shown the evidence, generally there are two reactions. The majority usually say, I don't want to see and I don't want to study the facts. Leave me alone. Others say, don't confuse me with the facts. I already have made up my mind. If you already believe there is going to be no flood, it doesn't matter what Noah says. You've already made up your mind. It doesn't matter if the animals all go into the ark and you can understand what in the world this means. No, it doesn't matter. I've already made up my mind. It cannot rain. It doesn't matter what evidence comes. Don't mess around. Don't fill my mind with facts. I already know what I want to believe. Isn't it interesting that God uses animals sometimes to prove things? There's a video that just came out. I mentioned the story to you some time ago, but there's a video that just came out. I don't have it yet, but a friend of mine called Lauren, for nearly 20 years, has a family of beavers in his backyard that work from sun up to sundown, hard workers, and they work 6 days a week. For the last 20 years, a family of beavers has never worked on Sabbath. Only Sunday to Friday. And it occurs to me that God is not done using animals to show which is the right day of salvation. There was a lady in Puerto Rico 2 weeks ago where my wife and I were coming through. My two sons also, they were with us. She wrote me out some of her dreams And in one dream, a friend of hers said, I wonder which is the true day of worship. And so she was asking the Lord, and in her dream she saw like the question went shooting up into heaven. And later that night, like an answer came down to her. Look at nature and it will tell you. That's an interesting one, huh? I've never really looked at nature to see which day is the Sabbath. But could it be that God has plans for nature? Could it be that God will tell the animals what to do because humans cannot control animal behavior? If animals start keeping Sabbath, that would be a very interesting argument. That, by the way, that was the last argument before the door of the ark closed. The animals made their choice. Could it be that God once again is going to use the animals before the door closes again? Something for us to be watching, right? There are three waves of change. Dr. Peter Wagner, professor of church growth at the Fuller Theological Seminary, says three waves of change that Christian churches are going to be growing through these three waves. One is Pentecostalism is going to sweep across. Charismatic movements are going to sweep across, and we've seen that now for the last 20 years, something, 30 years. And at the very end, the last wave that will convince people is signs and miracles. Oh, if it's a miracle, I believe. Some televangelists heal people and they believe. One Adventist pastor that I heard about had a daughter or a son, a child that was dying, could not get any help, went to see a televangelist. The child was healed. He left his faith and joined that church. If you believe and you filled your mind with signs and wonders, which Satan can do, you will be caught up in that third wave. Most people in the world believe that there are signs and wonders, it is God doing it. But according to Pastor John MacArthur, which is a very respected evangelical pastor, the third wave is destroying like a destroying tsunami, is sweeping across Christendom, causing chaos and confusion in the churches. Because God's word is out of place. If you have a miracle, you have no need for God's word anymore. Do you understand? It's supernatural. It has to be God. I'm convinced. Don't confuse me with the Bible. Yep, sure enough, I left some Spanish on it. It's supposed to say signs and symptoms when receiving the Holy Spirit. In the Alpha classes in Toronto, Toronto has a big place where they teach Alpha classes, the following signs have been noticed as people receive the Holy Spirit, in quotes. They laugh and cry without stopping. It's called drunkenness in the Spirit. Others feel like a fire burning in their body and they speak in tongues. Some bark like a dog and some growl like a lion. That sounds to me like possession. Some throw themselves on the floor and they're twisting and turning. Some lose consciousness. There is also vomiting in the Spirit. Wow. Is that one of the fruits of the Spirit? Vomiting? Some throw communion wine on their clothing and soak themselves down. Others take off their clothes and there's been some immoral acts. All through the Holy Spirit, supposedly. There's no focus on prayers or on Bible study in these classes. The focus is on trying to feel good about yourself. No confession of sins or corrections in order to help people and not to make people feel badly. You want to maximize the good feelings. You focus on kindness and courtesy, love, happy feelings, interesting subjects. Never make people feel uncomfortable. You don't want to talk about sins and repentance, do you? Jesus said in John 16:8, when the Spirit of truth has come, He will reprove the world of sin, righteousness, and of judgment. If you listen to the prophets and read the Bible, you will find that the messages of God's messengers is not about making you feel comfortable, it's about bringing you to repentance. Correction. There are some very well-known speakers that teach this philosophy. Rick Warren, in his book, The Purpose-Driven Life, I remember somebody mailed it to me. I didn't know anything about it, and I was reading. I didn't finish the book, but after about two or three chapters, I get, something doesn't ring right, and I just left it. I didn't finish it. But the purpose, the thing is, don't focus on theology or sacrifice or the cross of Jesus. How to create mega churches through the marketing of beautiful things that are less offensive and less traumatizing. How to create a community of Christians united in brotherhood without bringing Christian beliefs, doctrines, or principles into focus. Spread those philosophies by inviting and teaching other church leaders from other churches and work in small groups. Now, working in small groups is a very good thing, but the problem with working in small groups has been to control what they study. That's the problem, not the small groups. Because if you tell people what they can study and you focus them on areas, for example, in South America, they've been using small groups for a long time, and we know South American division, Inter-American division are rapidly growing divisions. They've used small groups for a long time. But recently, they've been told not to study prophecy. They've been told you have to study this and this. To grow in a small group, you have to study the materials that we give you. And stop focusing on prophecy in Daniel and Revelation. There's the danger, not the small groups. The danger is a small group is easier to refocus in a different direction. So, mixing the good with the bad. Bill Hybels, the pastor of Willow Creek Church, through this philosophy has created a mega church worth $34 million, 13,000 members, and in just 1999 alone, he taught 76,000 pastors how to attract more members. More than 3,300 congregations have united with his church. In other words, they listen. Every time he preaches, they project the... They're kind of like a spread out church. They're an extension of the same church. In this church, there is no piano or organ. They do not preach about repentance and sin. They practice a guiltless church service. Drama, multimedia, entertainment. The focus is on self-dignity and self-worth. Both men and women ordained into the ministry. In this, Rick Warren in his Saddleback Church wrote a book called 40 Days of Purpose. And has received the support, and this is official publication, received the support of the Assemblies of God, Baptist Church, Church of God, Free Evangelicals, Holy Pentecostal International, Seventh-day Adventist Church, Presbyterian, Lutheran, Nazarene, Catholic, Methodist, Mormon, Jewish, and many others. More than 8,000 churches have sent 108,000 pastors to receive training, and another 180 have received training through satellite programs. You see, this is a big influence on North America. And I want to tell you what we do in North America affects the whole world. If we go in a certain direction, we have the top seminaries. We have the top educational institutions. We have Loma Linda and Andrews University. They come from all over the world to study at our universities, and then they go back and they teach in those universities. What we do in North America eventually affects the entire world. The General Conference is here. Like Pastor Jeremiah Davis said one time, there are more demons in Maryland in Silver Spring than anywhere else in the world. And we were saying, what in the world is he talking about? Well, he says, the devil knows where the head of the Adventist Church is. He knows the Adventist Church has the message for the last days. And where do you think he's going to focus his attack on? Trying to attack the head. So, we know that God's people are under attack. We need to pray for our leaders. We need to pray for our pastors. We need to pray for all our leaders because they are more under attack than the average. Those who know the truth are under attack more than the average. So you focus. Strategy number one, you focus on personal growth and development. Meditation means methods to reach a higher spiritual plane. Materials include writings of Spiritists, Jesuits, Pagans, and Homosexuals. 40 Days of Purpose by Rick Warren does not focus on biblical teachings or loyalty to God. Now, the strange thing is that the Spanish version, the English version, as I can tell, was pretty good. We have a, here we, the Adventist Church published, I forget what it's called, 40 Days of something, there's a prayer. It seemed to be pretty well centered on the Bible and the spirit of prophecy, from what I could tell. But it comes from this basic philosophy of 40 days and 40 days of stuff. But the one in Spanish is not so good. It quotes almost all those writings and all the authors. And when we received one in South America, we just simply went through and checked all of the quotes from all the people, and it's filled with Spiritists, Jesuits, pagans, and homosexuals. They're all in there, in the Spanish version. And every elder in every church is supposed to study it and follow it. So, we said, excuse me, we first took it to the leadership and we just said, could you explain who these people are? No. We don't know who they are. We didn't publish it. It came from up there. Well, but before you distribute it, shouldn't you read it? No. It comes from up there. If it comes from up there, it's okay. But shouldn't you at least read it? Nobody of the pastors that were distributing had ever read it. They just simply receive and distribute. Of course. When I used to work in the Venezuelan Union, I work in unions for 15 years, you generally have a very good relationship with your other institutions, and whatever you send, the policies you go through, you read them, you also vote them, and you go on. Why? There's no reason to distrust your leaders. But what happens if Satan is able to get something in there? Even church organizations have to filter what comes from above. We know that the North American division and several European divisions and the South Pacific division are in direct conflict with the General Conference. We know that. You know that, I hope. At the last Fall Council a few weeks ago, the General Conference took steps to communicate very courteously and very nicely to all the unions and divisions that are not in harmony with its policy on women's ordination to please put things in order. They did a very good job, and they did it in a good Christian spirit. I approved of the way they did it. My approval has nothing to do with it. I just appreciated the way they did it. Just the spirit behind it was done in a fine Christian way. Well, the reaction has been to distance themselves in many places from the General Conference. I know of at least one division that is trying to change its name. I know of several unions that are trying to put the assets outside of the Adventist Church as fast as possible, so that when they're called on the carpet, the assets no longer belong to the Adventist Church. So there's a reaction on both ways. But you know what the Spirit of Prophecy says? The advice of Sister White was, when the ship was going to hit an iceberg, an authority voice said, "Meet it." And the ship did not try to go around the iceberg. It went straight into it. In fact, added full power. There was a terrible shake, and the ship hit the iceberg. It was damaged, but it did not sink. If the Titanic would have hit the iceberg head on, it would not have sunk. Never try to dodge an iceberg. It's better to hit the iceberg head on. Regardless of the consequences, deal with it head on. And that's what the General Conference is trying to do. Thank the Lord for that. Unity is required in God's church. If we lose some of the unity, at least those that are left are in unity. But if you allow anything to happen, what you have is congregationalism. There's no world church anymore. There's no world mission, no world vision anymore. It's all, everybody does their own thing. Praise the Lord that we're trying to work in unity. Not everybody sees it. Great percentages of the world church see it differently. But we have to aim for working under God's direction. One of the strategies, number two, loyalty to leaders in order to avoid problems. Obedience to leaders. All the members in Rick Warren's church should sign a membership covenant where they promise to protect the unity of the church following the leadership. Jesus' disciples confronted the same problem in Acts 5:27 when they were told not to preach. They were told not to preach the name of Jesus anymore. You're filling Jerusalem with all these teachings and you're going to make us responsible for his death. What was their answer? We ought to obey God rather than man. Loyalty to God comes first. Now here's something interesting. In 1973, the Adventist Church in Hungary was under the control of communism, according to Adventist News Network, May 4, 2015, last year. I've been to Hungary many times. We have a Hungarian television network, two of them. And so I know the story, but I'm quoting now. This came from the Adventist official news network. The church entered into cooperation with the Free Council of Churches. There were 518 members, including pastors, that protested, and they were immediately thrown out of the church. Without a biblical basis, says the Trans-European Division. These members then formed a community of Adventists called Kerak. We have a Hungarian sister here. She knows the story. In April of 2015, an agreement was signed between Kerak and the Adventist Church, and at the General Conference, they were welcomed in back into the church. Now, there are several unknown details, even to the General Conference, that I would like to tell you about. I was in favor and did all I could to help in getting things reconciled. But this, let me tell you what happened. The Adventist Church in 1973 was under the control of communism, and here are some other details. The church members were all asked in Hungary to sign a covenant of loyalty and obedience to the church leaders. The protest was not only against joining the Council of Churches, it was also, they were asked to sign a loyalty to the administration of the union. The church members protested, our loyalty is first to God. We can't sign loyalty to men. Well, 30% of the church was disfellowshipped in one day for not signing that. When Pastor Neil Wilson came to Hungary, since they were not allowed to come into the church, they waited outside. And Pastor Neil Wilson stood outside of the church there in Budapest and spoke to the brethren. They said, Pastor, we're still loyal to the church. We still love the church. We have not apostatized. We were all thrown out of the church because we would not sign a loyalty to man. That's our only protest. We're not being disloyal to the church. We still believe in a division and a general conference. We just don't know how to work this out on the union level. Pastor Neil Wilson said, my brothers and sisters, I am one with you. We will fix this problem. He thought. The very next day, the government, the union president told Pastor Neil Wilson, the minister of whatever they call the ministry there, and their ministry of churches and, what's that?
The minister of religion.
Of religion. The minister of religion would like to see you. Well, everybody said, how come the minister of religion even knows what happened? Well, it's a communist country. People know what happens. Because you have people on the inside in communist countries telling the government everything. So Pastor Neil Wilson and the union president went to see the minister of religion. And the minister said, if you work with those disfellowship people, we will close the Adventist church down in Hungary. Well, Pastor Neil Wilson didn't want that. So he refused to communicate with them anymore. The brother in the Kerak, they felt very hurt because their general conference president had made a promise and he would never communicate anymore with them. Many years went by. In 2014, 2 years ago, I was over in Hungary. And they said, we would like to have a meeting with Pastor Ted Wilson. He's now the GC president. We have written to him, and he doesn't want to meet with us. But we would like to meet with the GC administration to explore the possibility of joining and working out this problem. Besides, we now know something we didn't know back in those days. And I was shown the documents. After communism had failed in Hungary, it was shown that the union president was an employee of the government. The union president was a communist spy. No wonder the government knew what was happening. And it was this communist spy who threw everybody out. So they said, is it possible that a communist spy on the employment of communist payroll should be allowed to cause damage to God's church? Shouldn't the General Conference step in and correct it once they know? So I said, I think Pastor Ted Wilson would be willing to do that if he understood the situation. They said, well, we've written a letter and he doesn't want to meet with us. I looked at the letter, and it says, we would like to meet with you in Germany, and it's in the other, and I said, that's the problem. Pastor Ted Wilson cannot meet with you in Europe, where he's under tremendous pressure himself. You need to ask to meet with him at the General Conference, and you need to allow the union to be present, and once that is agreed upon, if you want to meet with him privately, I'm sure he will do that. Well, they said, would you write the letter, please? And so I wrote the letter. I wrote the letter for the Kedok brethren, and they sent it to the General Conference, and promptly Pastor Ted Wilson agreed. And so they asked him if they could have a private meeting with him for an hour, and he agreed. And they met with him, and they showed him all the documentation about the communist leader that had been a union president that caused all the problems. And then they had the meeting with the administration, and unfortunately, only part of the group was able to reconcile, and part was not. But they tried. It was an attempt to try to do it. There were some things that were unreconcilable. However, what happened to the church in Hungary is also happening in other parts of the Adventist church today, where loyalty to man is becoming important if you're going to stay in the church. The reason I'm preaching this today is that I hope it never happens here in North America. The sooner we know what happens in other parts of the world, the more protected we are at home. Because now we're aware. Now we're on the alert. We must never change our loyalty to God in exchange for loyalty to man. We know the great controversy is all about that, don't we? Except we're looking at the Catholic Church as the great compromise when the devil is attacking from the inside in the Adventist Church. Be loyal to God inside, and when times come in the future when outside attacks, we will be loyal outside too. But it's hard when we're looking outside, it's hard to recognize when things happen inside. And let me tell you, brethren, they're happening today inside the Adventist Church. People are asked to be loyal to man and obedient no matter what, or else they're being erased. Thousands are being thrown out in other countries. Be loyal to God. The church is safe when our loyalty first is to God. If our pastors are loyal to God, if our administrators are loyal to God, if everybody, the church members, are loyal to God, the church is in good hands. God knows how to take care of His church. Let's go on rapidly. Alpha classes also teach you how to deal with opposition. You identify those that are resistant. You evaluate and determine the level of resistance. You convince those that have low resistance, those that have high resistance to the direction you want to go. You are to be separated, discredited, and erased from church membership as fast as possible. The influence these teachings have had on the church, we'll let the Adventist Review state. In December 18, 1997, the Adventist Review confirms that Adventist pastors and members are one of the biggest groups that regularly attend Willow Creek courses. The Adventist Review confirms that at that time, when they wrote the article, three Adventist congregations left the Adventist Church and joined themselves due to the influence of Willow Creek. So it is causing damage. The Adventist Review confirms that there is a focus on small groups, discovering gifts, friendship evangelism, experimentations of new worship methods, and contemporary styles in the use of drama. If you have seen some strange things happening, you know where it's coming from now. At least you should be awake. At least you should know what's happening. You think Satan is going to sit still at this last generation and not do anything? He's going to attack in any way he can, with subtle changes from within, so eventually the whole ship can be changed. We have to go on. God has sons and daughters in the Protestant and the Catholic churches. He's attacking all of them. But the Adventist Church, and the name Seventh-day Adventist, by the way, has a very special meaning. Sister White says that the very name Seventh-day Adventist is an attack against falsehood. We should be proud of the name Seventh-day Adventist, and we should seek to live up to the standards that God gave this beautiful church. The mission of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is to elevate God's character of love, to demonstrate the perfection of God's law and eternal standards, demonstrate loyalty. The name of the church is a rebuke to those who would set aside God's law, We must warn the world that his judgment has come, and we must show the world how to avoid the mark of the beast and destruction by fire. The strategies are to keep Satan's strategies are to keep the church asleep and unprepared, fill homes and church with worldly entertainment, clothes, food, worship styles, take the focus off of God's word, place emphasis on human authorities who are contaminated with spiritualism and pagan doctrines, infiltrate educational institutions in order to destroy the teachings of Protestantism. You know, next year they're going to give the official death knell to Protestantism. You know what country the Pope is going to? I thought it was going to be Germany, but it isn't. Germany, 500 years ago, next year, that's when Martin Luther nailed the 95 Theses on the door. 500 years. Well, it's not going to be Germany. They went after Denmark, but Denmark did not agree, so they're going to Sweden. These are Lutheran countries. And the Pope is going to celebrate the official death of Protestantism and Lutheranism next year in Sweden. We have a great work to do in a short time. You know, I was just in Brazil, and a man and his wife were there at our meeting that we had at the TV station. Those that support and record, we had a little meeting just for those little team of people that participate, just to say thank you very much. And the husband told his story. And he said, I was in a dream as real as I'm sitting here today. And I was walking along shoulder to shoulder with four or five people in a long line. And as I was walking, there was a man facing us looking, and he would say, left, 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 you, right, left, left. And almost everybody was on the left. Occasionally there was somebody on the right. And when he got there, the man said, left. He said, why? Why am I in the left? Why am I with the great majority of people? That means I'm lost. And while he was thinking this in his mind, an angel touched him and said, you almost were saved. Almost. Why was I almost saved? He didn't say the words. He just thought them. But the angel touched him again and said, because you ignored the small details. And then he said, oh Lord, if only I could have another chance to take care of the small details. And the angel touched him again and said, God has heard your prayer. You have another chance. Boom! He woke up. And he said, all I know is God is a God of details. You understand the message of God there? So many times we just, little details. Well, it doesn't matter that. That doesn't matter. And that doesn't matter. And that doesn't. Excuse me. It does matter. God is a God of details. And his wife receives another dream in August. Not her first dream for her, but received a dream. She told her story too. She's a professional singer. She sings all over Brazil. A beautiful voice that she shares. But we asked her, please share what God showed you. She said, God gave me the dream just like that. It was so real. It was like I'm sitting here again today. Don't know if it's a vision or what, but she said, I woke up and God said, there is one small detail that you're forgetting. I have given you instructions on where you should live, and it's not where you are living right now. You're living in the city. And I've given you instructions on where to live, and you are ignoring that very small detail. 2017 is going to be a very traumatic year, and you need to put things in order. That was all the dream was. They immediately sold their house, and 2 weeks ago, they were making the move into the country. Now, this is not a time to flee. No! It's a time to reach the cities. But we are told to live outside. God in His mercy has held the winds for a long time. God in His mercy, through His love for His children, has held things far beyond any human expectation would believe. But you know what? There is a time when the winds are going to be released. If there is any small details in your life you need to put in order, please put them in order. The first promise Jesus ever made, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise, but really the word is crush. It will crush thy head, and thou shalt crush his heel. My wife just fell down a couple weeks ago, as she was running around the airplane, and suddenly the pavement went up an inch or so, and she didn't see it, and she hit it. She had things in her hands. She dislocated her shoulder and popped out. Out on the pavement, on a hot sun. She fell on her lip. It was torn. She was bleeding. And we just felt so sorry. I called my brother. He told me how to relocate it. And so I followed the advice. And we pop, but it didn't go back in. She went, ah! We went to the military hospital there, and they took us to the big hospital, and three men tried to pull her arm in. I felt so badly for her. She was there. They couldn't do it, so they had to put her in general anesthesia and relocate it. She's still recovering today. But you know what? That wasn't a crushing blow. That was only a dislocation and a little bit of a fracture. What if somebody crushed your heel? How long would you be walking? How painful would it be? Huh? If you just bruise your heel, it's hard. Bruising is not as bad as crushing. The word is used to crush. Crush ahead. Now, I just reached down the other day to get something and I threw it. I looked back and there, 3 inches from my hand, was a very poisonous snake. It could have struck me, but it didn't. Well, guess what I did? I got a big stick and I went, boom! I didn't bruise his head. I crushed it flat. Every bone in his head was crushed. You know what? If somebody crushed your heel, how hard it would be? But God is going to crush the head of this serpent. And our own brother Jimmy from here is doing a series of presentations that have been a great blessing to me. And he talks about a stone cut without hands that's going to strike the image on its feet. And it's not just any stone. It's a stone that God has cut out and prepared to destroy the nations of the earth. And that rock is not just a rock, it's a gem. It's a precious gem. It's God's church. And God will pour out His Spirit and seal His people. And that's going to be a beautiful rock cut without hands that will strike the image on its feet, and all the nations will turn into dust. And that beautiful rock will eventually fill the whole world. God is preparing a people today to receive the seal. The angels are told in Revelation 7:3 to hold the winds until the people of God are sealed on his forehead. And Satan knows that if God seals his people, his head will be crushed. Strategy number one is to keep God's people asleep in their sins until it's too late. We are told that clearly. So they will not be prepared to receive the divine seal. I appeal to all our church leaders and pastors not to be contaminated with worldly theories and teachings of evangelical mega churches. Shun it. Turn your back on it. It distracts us from our final mission. Hold the word of God up and defend it as your light, with your life if necessary. Be loyal and obedient to God first and then to man in second place. Be God's ambassador. Allow God to prepare us and to receive the divine seal. Prepare our church members for the final crisis to avoid the mark and receive the seal. Jesus is coming back soon. His coming is imminent. And I want to be there that day, don't you?
Amen.
It's going to happen very soon. And though for years I've been saying that the Adventist Church, though we have the name Adventist, we really don't believe Jesus is coming back soon. And last year at the General Conference, we took the word imminent out of our basic fundamental beliefs. And nobody did that to us. We did it ourselves. What does that mean? The majority of Seventh-day Adventists do not believe in the imminent coming of Jesus Christ, which we believe for 150 years. That's just reality. Someday He will come soon. It could be 100 years or longer. No, brothers and sisters, we're living in the last generation. Jesus' coming is imminent. Only the angels, God's mercy, the angels through His mercy are holding the winds of strife a little longer for us. Will you get ready? Will you accept God's invitation today? Don't sleep at this time. It is fatal to sleep spiritually at now. It is still time The door is still open, and it won't be open much longer. Be loyal to God above all in everything you do. And remember, every time you choose to sin, you are voting. You are voting that Jesus should wait a little longer. Don't sin. Don't watch that movie. Don't listen to that worldly music. Don't read that book. Don't read that novel. Fill your mind with God's word. Place your ballot in God's box. Jesus, come quickly and prepare for the great seal. I can't wait. I pray that I will be there. I pray you will be there. May God bless each of you today. And in order to finish now, I will just want to finish the video production by ending with a word of prayer, and then we will have our closing hymn. Would you kneel with me as we close, please? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this very clear presentation, Lord, from the different evidences that we have collected that Jesus is coming soon. We are under attack. But if we would have to be under attack, we are your people. We're the remnant people with a special message and a special name for this special time. You have blessed us. You have given us so much, and for that we're so thankful. Help us not to turn our back on you. Help us not to forget our mission. Please be with our pastors and our leaders, many of which, Lord, have rebelled against you like we have. We are stiff-necked and hard-hearted, but we ask for forgiveness, and we ask for humble hearts, and we ask that we will pay attention to the small details while the door is still open. Prepare us and seal us, Lord, and those who watch this message and those who feel the calling of God on their hearts, may they at this moment turn their hearts to you and say, Lord, I give everything I have and everything I am to you. Take me, prepare me, discipline me, and use me in the final spreading of the message. And may we receive the seal of the living God very soon and see you come in the clouds of glory. We pray and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.